It's 1 to 5, left to right. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Right, you now have James Hoffman and Javier to talk to you about the flavor kit.
Hey there, I'm just going to talk really briefly, just for a second, just about why we got involved in this project. And before I do, just quickly, can you raise your hand if you work for a business that uses taste as part of your quality control? All right, so good, we're in the right room. We got involved almost for a pretty selfish reason, which is, like you, we could control our quality and we aim for quality using taste as part of that feedback loop. And the sad truth is that coffee tasters are passionate, but often, once you put them under a little bit of analysis, well, we're not very good at what we do. And the reason that we're often not very good at what we do is that to date, we've kind of lacked standards. And for me, the opportunity to help create some standards was simply too good to miss. I think it's something that's hugely valuable. And it's not something that I think is necessary, because I don't think we all need to be green buyers. I'm not a green buyer. I'm not thinking about this from a green buyer perspective, where I can communicate better back to producers, though that's a hugely important part of it. But for my business or my team, we can talk, we can create common language is one thing. And two, we can set sort of a bar for how capable we should be at tasting to do our job well. And once you create standards, and Javier is going to talk a little bit more about this, then I think we can improve what we do, we can monitor what we do, we can, you know, focus on that aspect of our business and actually start to execute on what we want, which is to make the coffee that we sell taste better and better and better. And so this for me is hugely exciting. It's almost like a selfish opportunity. I so desperately want this to be a thing that the fact that it can be now is wonderful. And kit one is great, and there's more interesting stuff coming. But the fact that afterwards, when you've tasted these, if you disagree with any of the tastes, that's why we need them. Because we don't yet really have proper common language around taste, and we don't have standards. So I think you're going to really enjoy this. So that's all for me for now. Any Q&A, happy to. But I'll hand you over to Javier. Thanks.
Hey, thank you, James. Thank you. Good evening. I would like to take the next part of this session today. And we're going to do a practical session later on, and we're going to taste a few flavor standards. I want to taste some defects that naturally occur in coffee. But before that, I would like to set up the scene a little bit and see what we're going to cover today. And we've been talking today a lot about the need for standardization, basically. We need common language. We need to everybody to speak the same language, know exactly what we're talking about, and see what the problems arise when we don't talk in the same language. I'm going to see a little bit about the source and the defects, so basically relating it to how we train to detect all these off flavors that might occur in coffee and what is actually out there and what is being used. And then we're going to do a bit of a tasting session at the end, and then we'll be open for the Q&A. So coffee is a very diverse community, and sometimes if you are focused in just the little bit you do, you lose a little bit of vision of how many steps, how many people, how many different things are involved in getting coffee to the consumer. So basically it's a very, very complex process, from the growers to the exporters, importers, farmers, roasters, distributors, graders, back to the barista. And each one of these steps, there is always a risk that something going wrong, something that might affect the quality of the coffee in the end. So basically you have to know exactly what is going on and where is going on, and to be able to identify what is the defect and sourcing it to the origin, basically, so you can do something about it. So when we talk about sensory and flavor active, is basically is what we do, is we do sensory and we help the beverage industry do quality control. When you do sensory, you have to differentiate between what is quality control, part of the supply chain, and what is the barista selling coffee. When you look at towards the consumer, you can be more poetic. You focus basically in the positives, and you can use any language you want, any language that will give you basically an advantage with competitors and better selling your coffee. When you talk about quality control as the supply chain, we are talking about science, and we're talking about what can go wrong with the coffee. And these are things that there's been a lot of work being done, and we know a lot about what is going wrong.
but you have to find a way to describe it precisely, so we all know exactly what you're talking about. And then the second part of it is you have to find a way to train yourself to identify how to recognize these defects that might be very rare and occur randomly. So it all goes back to why it's so hard to standardize flavors. In theory, it should be very simple to describe the flavor, and thus it is. But the thing is a bit more complicated than that. And it goes down to basically cultural differences. Basically, we all grow in different cultures. We are all exposed when we are young to different inputs, to different cuisines. So basically the language we use is going to be different based on what we experienced when we were young. I remember personally when I started doing sensory and I started doing many years ago in beer, when they described to me a flavor called banana, we all know what banana tastes like. But then something they said, well, it tastes like pear drops. And as a Spanish, I didn't know what a pear drop is. Apparently it's a kind of sweet that is very common in England. But I never tasted a pear drop in my life. So that term to me didn't mean anything. And then when I go to the United States and you describe a flavor that might be light struck, they describe it as skunky because they say it smells like a skunk. And it might be a very definite smell, but I was never exposed to the smell of a skunk. So that word to me meant absolutely nothing. And it can be a very, very precise way to describe it, but it has to be something that everybody understands. And it goes that, how do you calibrate the people with different culture, different genetics, and different taste preferences? Because the way you perceive a flavor might be different from the way the people perceive the same flavor. And it goes down to, if you see this picture, and we ask, which one of these is red? Are they all red? How do you describe with words each one of these? And maybe you might find a way to do it, if you're an artist, to describe what these different colors are. The problem is that we all see them differently, and we all different shades of red. So what something might be to me more red, for someone else might be a different shade of red. So basically, there's lack of guidance, we need a reference. In the case of colors, there is a reference called the Pantone, and defines exactly what shade of red it is, basically. So going back to coffee, and speaking about the defects, we have some green defects, as for example, the phenol, medicinal, and potato that occur randomly. You might find too how to describe them, and you might think that you know how they taste, but the thing is you might never experience them because you never found them in your green beans. But there's been studies being done, and basically you know exactly what is the chemical responsible for that flavor. So basically what we have to do is, if you can replicate the chemical responsible for the defect, then you can train the people to recognize the defect. And basically that's what we're doing, and that's what I'm gonna show you a bit later on. So this is the new approach to the coffee quality management, and basically in Flavor Active we partner with Square Mile Coffee, with coffee enterprises in the US, and they are telling us exactly, giving us guidance of what is needed in the coffee industry. What are the major defects, and what are the chemicals responsible for the defects? And just to show you who we are, basically we are a team, international team, and we have people that look after different regions, and we have people in Asia, in Africa, we have people in Latin America, in the US. So we are very aware of the cultural differences of the different regions, and we can basically help them. We're a company that we've been in the market for almost 20 years, and we have helped some of the major companies develop and deploy their sensory plants. These are some companies we have long-term agreements to help them develop their sensory. And basically what we do, it can be said in the three stages or three parts. We do the flavor standards that we're going to see a bit later on. We do sensory training, and we do calibration of the trainers. And as I said before, we work with the associations, international associations, the CEA, the CAE, the ICO. And so basically what we're trying to do here is gather their knowledge and apply them to the products that we offer. So going back to how you train, how do you train today? As I said, one way to train is to find to wait up until a defective bean pops up and then use it for training. And this is a way that is being used nowadays. The problem is sourcing of the beans. When is going to find the bean that is defective? And the problem is the intensity. How intense is going to be this bean? It may be different. So you might train one day with defective beans, and the intensity of the flavors or the effects might be different from the next one. You might use smell pots, but then you lose part of the sensory input, which is basically the mouthfeel and the flavor and what gives you when you have the defect in your mouth. So what we do is the sensory kits, and the sensory kits, basically what we do is we source the defect, we put it in powder form, and then we can use it dissolved in water, and then you can use that to train the people, and that's what I'm going to show it in a minute. It's something that they are safe to drink and they're safe to smell. Okay, so what we're going to see today is the series one. We're going to test it. I want to tell you what it is, each one of the flavors. And they are, as I said, the flavors in powder form. They just need to dissolve them in water and then they're ready to taste. So if you all follow me, just try the sample number one and describe it to me, please.
Which one is number one?
The left. You can smell it and you can taste it.
Okay, number one is on the left.
Mm-hmm. On the left, from left to right. How would you describe this sample? Any ideas, people that work in the tasting?
Grass.
Banana.
Grass?
Grass.
The first one is grassy. I noticed that I show an icon of grass. It's important when you do sensory training, not only to relate to the sensory input from your nose and your mouth, also for your eyes. You see it. So according to the Coffee Cuppers handbook, this is taste and odor, giving a distinctive herbal character, similar to freshly mown alfalfa. And this is the origins, basically. What do you think of it? Did everybody detect the grass? Both in smell and taste? Is it similar to the one you found in defective coffee beans? Have you ever found this defect? No? Have you seen it before? Okay, you can go to sample number two. It'll be quite prominent on the nose and very intense in the mouth. How would you describe this?
Mold?
Soil.
Yeah.
Earth? Musty? Earthy?
Soil.
We see there are a bit of a difference in the way you describe it. So that important thing of creating a common language. This is earthy. Earthy. This is the smell and taste of freshly dug earth. So basically the origin is the result of the fats in the coffee beans absorbing organic material from the ground in the drying process or in the harvest. So this is earthy. Can you please go to sample number three? How would you describe this?
Medicine?
Oyster? Is it similar to the previous one?
No.
Mm-hmm. A little bit.
Moldy?
This one is moldy, musty. It's TCA that we heard all about in the previous presentation. Trichloroanisole. Sometimes this one is confused with earthy, but they are different. The chemical is different, and the sensory sensation that gives you in the nose and the mouth, they are completely different. So this is a very important. This is a quite interesting flavor because it's very odor active. The amount of compound you need to trigger a response is very small, in the range of nanograms per liter. So a very, very, very small amount of this flavor will have a huge impact in the final quality of the coffee. This is musty. Can you please smell and taste? Next one. How do you describe it?
Leather.
Creosol.
Medicinal.
You see that there is a bit of disagreement between the tasters, the expert tasters. This is leathery. It's a smell of leather. As a result of the breakdown of fats in the coffee beans. Excessive amount of heat applying during the drying process gives you a leathery smell and taste. Can you smell it and can you taste it? What is more intense, in the smell or in the taste?
Smell.
In the smell. Not in the taste? Depends. Each one of you will be different. Some people will get it more intense in the nose and more intense in the taste.
Yes.
And then we can taste the last one. What does it taste like? Mushroom. Fungus. It's a mushroom. That's the reminiscent of edible mushrooms, herbaceous and savory, often meaty, caused by improper drying of storage in humid conditions. Sometimes the aged coffee can have a mushroom-like character. So basically, what we've seen here is a new tool to train your tasters, but you don't have to wait for the bad bean to pop up. What you have to do is just go to what is the chemical responsible for the bad taste, and then train your tasters in it. When we do the training, we use flavor icons. I think flavor icons are very important, especially when you are dealing through different people with different languages and different cultures. Some people learn much easier when they can have a visual reference to them. So that's what we use. And then we also use a common language. So we don't try to use each one describing the flavor the way they want, we use a common language. So, the important thing when you do a training is first that you have to set up a plan. It's important when you all do the training, initially everybody is very excited about it, everybody takes it very nicely, and they're all very, very happy to do the tasting. After they do the training, they all have a very high performance. But training in sensory is a little bit like any other activity, like a sport or like people that do music. You have to keep practicing. So once you do the training, you have to continue training in time. It's not something that you've done the training 6 years ago, you achieve some level, and that it will carry with you all the time. After a year, after 2 years, if you don't do any training, you don't do any calibration, your performance is going to go down. So whatever you do, When you set up a sensory plan, it's important that at regular intervals you recalibrate your panel and you do some retraining. So it's important as well that whenever you do it and however you do it, regularly, and it could be every 3 months, it could be every 4 months, you go back to your tasters and you make sure that they know exactly what they are tasting. And they know exactly if they can identify the flavors. And then you can always, when you do this, you can always apply metrics to it, and then you can see how good are your tasters. And then it's not a subjective measurement anymore. Then it's an objective, because then you can apply how good they are. Are they able to recognize all the flavors? Are they able to recognize 70% of the flavors? And when? It's important that you do, that you measure this and you compare time after time, and then you see whether in your panel you have the weak spots and whether your panel is strongest, So when you do the training, you focus in those parts where your panel is a bit weaker. And then, well, this was coffee sensory kit number one, which is, as I said, earthy, grassy, musty, leathery, and mushroom. For series two, what we plan is work on ferment and phenolic, potato, moldy, sour, quakery, medicinal, pulpy, and petroleum. And then series three, probably it will involve a bit more of the positive flavors of the coffee. So we not only focus in what is that can happen, bad happen to the coffee, it's also what the positive flavors are looking more towards your consumers and how can you describe the coffee to your consumers. Okay, so I would like to thank the ICAO and the CAOK for this opportunity and you for your attention. And if there are any questions, maybe we can ask.
Good evening. Thank you very much for the presentation. Just out of interest, how many organic compounds are there in each of these samples? Is there one particular organic compound, or are there numerous compounds that give the effect and the combined effect of the effect?
In this case, there is one compound. What we normally try to do is to find what is the compound responsible for the defect, if there is one. For example, the MOD is very clear because it's TCA. Some other defects are a bit more complex. The one that springs to mind is ferment. Ferment is something that there are a number of compounds responsible for ferment, and then here something that we might have to decompose it in a number of different compounds to create a capsule that gives you the ferment flavor.
Hi, I would like to know how safe is the compound? If you are extracting, the compounds, there is any clinical proofs that there is safety for each compound?
Yeah, all the compounds are manufactured to GMP standards and they are pharmaceutical grade. So they are, and they have full classification FEMA GRAS. So they are generally regarded as safe. The way they do it, and the way they're manufactured, and the intensity they have, they're perfectly safe to smell and to taste.
And there are clinical tests that
come? Yes.
Don't overdose on them, basically.
you cannot overdose on them. Basically, you'll have to.
Train your testing panel several times. That's my only concern. It is the same compound that you says is provoking the problem.
It is perfectly safe. These are the chemicals we are using. They are chemicals that naturally occur in the defective bean anyway. And when we train, we do intensive training. I've done training in one day where we do 50 samples with dopes, and there's no problem, there's no concern at all. You can use them intensively, and they're perfectly safe to be used.
How long does it take to identify the each compound? I think there's anything wrong.
How long, sorry?
How long does it take to identify, like, each chemical?
For us?
Yeah.
To
identify, like, how long the chemical is causing
This is something that it depends. Depends on the information that's out there and depends how much research has gone into it. For example, say moldy, it was straightforward, and earthy was straightforward, grassy straightforward. Things like, as I said, ferment and phenolic is taking longer because they are more complex. And as they said in the previous presentation, different people have different opinions of what this might be. So what we're trying to do in that case is look at the origin, look at what has been published, and look at what can we create a capsule that recreates those. It could be anything from 2 months to 6 months. It depends on them.
You mentioned the training process, and you said that you trained intensively. What does that entail? Is it literally just trying them over and over again and comparing them, or?
No, initially you start with the capsule calibrated at a certain concentration. The concentration that they have, the capsule, when you dilute it in 1 liter of water, is 3 times flavor threshold, which is quite a bit intense. It's a big hit of it. What we're trying to do there is to ensure that if not everybody, at least 70% of people will be able to identify it. Once you know what is the flavor and you're able to recognize it, then you go into threshold training, basically. And then what you do is you lower the intensity, you dilute it more, and then you're trying to see what is your threshold for that particular flavor, basically. And this is something that is intensity scaling and training, that's the second stage of training.
Excellent. Thank you.
How did you prioritize which flavors to profile first?
Basically by impact, and in this is something where we draw out on the knowledge of our partners and Square Mile Coffee and Coffee Enterprises, and they tell us which are the most relevant coffees, basically our importance. There is always that goes into it about the development time as well. I mean, it's something that then it might take longer or might not take longer, the difficulty of sourcing them. There is some technical aspects to it, basically, that putting them in powder form and things like that might take a bit longer. But basically what we're doing is our coffee experts tell us which one are the ones that we should go into the kits.
So do you think there might be some flavors that are quite hard to recreate?
There might be some that could be hard to recreate, yes, it could be. As I said, is because there is not a common language. Where we are relying is in different opinions of different people, and we are relying on the literature, basically. And sometimes people describe the flavors, but descriptions and words are important, but they don't convey all the information. So it's a complicated process. I mean, there is a lot of research going in the background before putting that into a capsule form.
Hi. My question is, for me, one of the most subjective takes or thoughts when is coffee over fermented? And I noticed that it's going to be on your next kit, so I was wondering how are you going to take the subjectivity out of what is a fermented coffee, and how do you plan on an objective definition of what is a fermented coffee flavor?
There are several ways you can do that, basically. If you're going to do a capsule that basically is representative of what a fermented bean is, what you can do is you can see what is the compound that is responsible for the majority of the fermented flavor, that is always in the fermented flavor. Even if it doesn't describe perfectly what a fermented bean is, because that have all the compounds, but it has a compound that always is always found in fermented coffee, then you train detecting that compound, and then you know that when you find it, it's a fermented. There might be something included to that. Another way you can do it is basically by creating a capsule that contains more, or creating two capsules or three capsules that prescribe, so you have a ferment kit. There are a number of ideas that we are doing at the moment.
Great. Well, a big hand for our speakers, please.